I should have been warned. Some viewers on our summer project were against a gun on the tank. But I did not listen. This video shows what happened and how I was punished. Greetsy YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. In Switzerland, every adult man is in the army and has its gun at home. Maybe this is the psychological reason for my choice. But I'm not a psychologist, I'm an engineer. So let's start with the story. If you look at the Discord channel of the summer project, you see that there are many possibilities to build a gun for a tank. But there is one favorite for an electronics engineer. A decent coil gun, sometimes also called rail gun, running purely on electricity. You could call it also the Tesla of guns. Viewers of GreatScott's channel know that he did such a gun and I did not want to repeat it here. I wanted, of course, more. Keep in mind, his build was 5 volts and 12 amperes. For all of you who do not know how such a coil gun works, it consists of a coil and an iron bullet, and it works like this solenoid here. If current flows through the coil, a magnetic force pulls the iron towards the middle of the coil, and it stays there as long as the current is applied. If the current stops, the coil force fades away and the iron is moved back by the spring. Not exactly a gun. Lovers of the film No Country for Old Men know, however, that it is possible to kill people using a similar principle. Anyway, let's stick to the story. If the inner iron runs free and you stop the current in the right moment, it continues on its way. And it leaves the coil on the opposite side. And if the current is high, the result is a fast-moving projectile. As a rule of thumb, more current and more turns on the coil results in more speed. And more current needs more voltage, of course. When I saw this instructable, I knew this is much closer to what I want. It uses a capacitor to store 400 volts and a thyristor to switch the current. This should provide the needed current. But the gun on the tank has to be remotely controlled, not manually. So we have to enhance it. And now the sad part of the story begins. I ordered the components as described in the instructable. A DC-to-DC converter which, according to its datasheet, should be able to output 400 volts, and unfortunately exceeded its specifications. A 100 microfarad capacitor for 450 volts, some copper wire, and a thyristor. Thyristors are the working horses of high voltage switching. The one I used was called 7-TPS12, and its datasheet says it can deal with more than 1200 volts and 70 amps, which is not the full truth. If you read the small print, you see it supports up to 1100 amperes for a short time. That is the stuff electric dreams are made of. It only needs a short trigger of 1.3 volts on his gate, and then it starts to conduct. Simple and efficient. So I started to print the inner part of the coil and coiled the copper wire using my electric drill. This is quite efficient and leads to a very tight coil, which is good for our purpose. Then I connected the parts. Now I have to confess something important. Since my years of study, I never touched high voltages anymore. With good reasons, as you will see. When I finished the wiring, I connected 12 volts to the DC converter, and really, the voltage on the capacitor started to increase to nearly 400 volts, as promised in the description on AliExpress. Then I did some research on the PC and did not look at the bench. Suddenly, a noise like a gunshot from the bench. But it was not my coil gun. It was one of the capacitors of the DC converter which exploded. The smell was awful and Dave Jones would talk about magic smoke. I have to say, I did not feel any magic in this smoke, and I also did not see any hallucinations like Steve Jobs when he consumed LSD. So, please do not expect a new iPhone from me. After cleaning up the mess, I did some measurements and discovered that the converter was able to produce much more than 400 volts. And the output capacitors are only rated at Chinese 400 volts, if you know what I mean. So, one of them exploded after a few minutes. This was the first victim of this project. And because it was the capacitor of the negative rail, it did not stop my ambitions and I was able to continue. After buying some decent nails and cutting the end off, I wanted to try the thing. Without thinking too much, I used the second rail of my bench power supply to provide the trigger voltage to the thyristor. The effect was a spark and a loud noise. When the smoke disappeared, I saw that I killed the second part of my bench power supply. Since then, it shows 50 volts and overcurrent, and I cannot change that anymore. And the size of the flash told me that the thyristor also did not survive. Why did this happen? Unfortunately, naive as I am with these high voltages, I connected the thyristor to the high side, which was, in this case, the wrong side. You can imagine how annoyed I was about forgetting to check everything before powering up. As usual, I had ordered a few thyristors more and corrected the circuit. And because I learned something, I used a 1.5 volt battery to power the gate. I did not want to sacrifice another valuable equipment of my lab. And really, it worked. The bullet moved quite fast out of the coil. And because I wanted to measure the current, I connected a 1 ohm resistor between the capacitor and the coil. On the low side this time, otherwise I would have to mourn my valuable oscilloscope. According to Ohm's law, this resistor, also called shunt resistor, shows 1 volt per ampere. And because the action is so fast, I had to use the oscilloscope to see what happened. Here we see that about 130 amperes circulated through the coil. And the whole thing just took a few milliseconds. Cool! What limited this current? Looking at the diagram, we see a capacitor, a shunt resistor, the thyristor, and the coil. The total resistance is 400 volts divided by 130 ampere equals around 3 ohms. 1 ohm comes from the shunt, which is quite a lot. The other come from the internal resistor of the capacitor, the thyristor, the wires, and the coil itself. You can imagine that the current was even higher when I removed the shunt resistor. Because of my misfortune, we can see how an electrolytic capacitor is built. If we look at its remains, we see that its connectors are quite thick. And the bigger capacitor has even thicker connections. By the way, this is the cap of the capacitor. Still more or less intact. I found it a few meters away from the explosion. I also had to add a switch to shut the DC converter down as soon as the capacitor was charged. Thyristors only stop to conduct at very low current levels. So it just stops conducting if the capacitor is completely discharged. But with the running converter connected to the capacitor, it never discharges completely, which created a short through the coil and kept the thyristor always on. This switch on the primary side of the DC converter solved the problem. At least I had now a working gun and I wanted to try it out outside the house. For that, I used the same quadcopter battery I used in the tank. In the final version, this should also power the gun. When I connected the DC converter to the battery, its 15 ampere fuse melted immediately. Now you know why I love my assortments. I quickly replaced the fuse. I had to add a 1 ohm resistor in series with the battery to limit the current. Now it worked. And I was able to do the tests with the battery as a power source. I was a happy man. At least as long as I suppressed any thoughts about my poor power supply. But the whole thing still only worked manually with a 1.5 volt battery. As a next step, I had to connect it to the ESP32 on the tank. But wait, you know I love my ESP boards, especially the newer ESP32. And I learned something from my previous experiments. 400 volts are dangerous for electronics parts, especially with a noob at the controls. So I went into my ESP8266 box and searched for the board with the least value for me. Not an easy task, because I love all of them. I wanted to start by automating the trigger, which needed at least 1.3 volts according to the datasheet. The 3.3 volts of the ESP should be okay for that. Said and done, I wrote a small sketch which triggered the gate pin for a few milliseconds. I also connected a USB isolator between the ESP and my computer. It is the same which should edit the video later on, so I did not want to destroy it. It worked somehow, and the thyristor was triggered. Then I heard the sound that the USB connector of the ESP was unplugged. Evidently, my ESP8266 board had died a nearly silent death. I do not exactly understand how this happened, but maybe the thyristor created a short voltage spike on the gate, or the high current changed the potential of the ESP. Let's count the casualties. A dead power supply, a completely destroyed capacitor, two dead thyristors, I do no more recall how the second one died, and a dead ESP8266. This was definitely enough for one day's work. And I had to change strategies completely. I wanted to isolate my electronics entirely from the high voltage parts. For such cases, I have a few optocouplers in my lab. I did some tests with them, but did not manage to get the gate triggered without additional transistors. So I gave up. Because I anyway had to use a relay to switch the primary side of the DC converter, I decided to use one of those ready-made modules also to trigger the gate. The last step was to measure the voltage across the capacitor to decide if the gun is armed. How do you measure 400 volts with an ESP? You create a voltage divider. You can use the following formula. I did not need an exact result here, so I choose 410 kiloohms and 810 ohms. Like that, the voltage should always be below 1 volt. The sketch is very simple. I need a button as an input and two output pins. One to switch the DC converter and one for the trigger. The output of the voltage divider is connected to the ADC of the ESP8266. You see, I still used a backup ESP8266 and not the ESP32 because I was not entirely sure if it will survive. If we have a look at the sketch, we see that we first switch the relay for the DC load on. To do that, we have to pull the pin to low. The charging process starts and we measure the voltage. As soon as the voltage reaches the desired level, the weapon is armed. And we wait for the button. I used the readily available flash button on the board connected to GPIO0 or D3. As soon as the button is pressed, the thyristor is triggered for 100 milliseconds and the gun fires. Now the charging can start again. So finally, the prototype is ready. This project created the biggest cemetery of dead parts and devices in the history of this lab, and I'm not sure when I will work with high voltages again. And I'm also not sure if this concept ends on the tank. It seems to be quite dangerous for noobs like me. In such moments where things get a little costly, I'm glad I have loyal supporters on Patreon and people who use the affiliate links in the video description. Thank you for your support. Without you, it would be difficult for me to do what I do now. Bye.